Welcome to the Spy Collection. Here is Anastasios, and in this episode we have something we haven't done before, thanks to your feedback. We'll review some photos from the Saab Bofors Dynamics NLAW lightweight shoulder-fired weapon system. NLAW stands for Next Generation Light Anti-Tank Weapon. Sadly, we've been unable to directly access the weapon system, or parts of it, for this episode, but due to the ongoing war between Russia and Ukraine, there is sufficient open source content to help us get a closer look at it. As always, links to all the referenced material is available in the video's description. Online you can find all sorts of articles and detailed videos on the operation, tech specs, and 10 laws being used in combat, but here our objective is to see what we can find from the open source photos of its internals, a combination of OSINT and TECHINT. And of course, all our analysis in this video is based on open source information. Briefly, this is where you install its removable battery. With this one you can set the brightness of its red dot sight, and then you select its mode of operation with this lever. Overall, NLAW is considered an advanced fire and forget missile system for infantry that can be configured by the operator to carry out either an overfly top attack, also known as OTA, usually used against armored vehicles, since the top is usually the least hardened part of it, or DA, meaning direct attack, most commonly used against structures. And this lever here sets the distance for the magnetic sensor activation that's inside the missile's warhead, and it can be set to either 20 or 100 meters. On the trigger hand, this switch is known as a storage or transportation safety, ensuring that you cannot use it without first flipping the switch. And opening the trigger's red cover powers on the system. Then with this black handle here, you can pull it and keep it like that in order to track the target for a few seconds, so that NLAW's computer can pre-calculate the trajectory it needs to follow after launch in order to hit the target. And then you press the trigger button to launch the missile.
Fire now. Okay, no drama.
If you'd like to learn in detail how to operate it, we'll leave a link in the description to a Ukrainian soldier's YouTube channel called Valgear, who's doing a thorough demonstration. Now, in terms of its users, of course that is its manufacturers, Sweden and United Kingdom, but Ukraine has quite possibly been the country that has used them most extensively in combat. Other nation states that have them at the time of this publication include Indonesia, Malaysia, Switzerland, and France. As always, we are no weapon experts, so this is an amateur's attempt for some TECHINT on this system. Please let us know what more you could discover from the shared material. We have three main parts: the trigger assembly that we just described in front of the NLAW, which is connected with a battery, and there is a small connector on the right of it that connects it with a missile launch device at the rear of the tube. We'll cover that last part in more detail in a bit. In front of it, NLAW has this bulky protective part, and inside is the missile, with its nose protected with this plastic black cover. Here is how that Kilo 170 Alpha 2 missile looks once removed. And here is how it looks once launched. Notice the dual sensor in the missile's nose. Actually, even that black cover has openings for those. Those are oriented to point downwards, and they are simple optical sensors, so that the missile knows what's up and what's down, since the missile is designed to detonate while flying over a target. Check this video for instance. And here is a stripped down view. NLAW is a fire and forget system that is using a combination of magnetic and optical sensors to identify the distance of detonation. So those are the optical sensors of that system. and the other part is clearer from the side view. This that looks like a large coil is the magnetic sensor of its detonation system. So this is what's configured when the operator is setting the OTA, DA and distance levers. In other words, the system comes with some pre-programmed modes of operation which change when the magnetic sensor will start working, and those levers select which program to run. It's also interesting how the different PCBs are connected to each other. If we exclude this cable that goes to the magnetic sensor, the rest have connections like this from one layer to the other. From this side, we can also read that it had a Coiltronics VP2 inductor along with Eaton Electronics FP3 series wire inductors. And right below its nose sensor, we have its warhead. What you see is the shaped charge that NLAW relies on to penetrate armor. Based on its specs, it provides over 500 mm, that's about 20 inches, of armor penetration. To do that is using one of the most well-known techniques called EFP, or explosively formed penetrator. Basically, you have this explosive that once detonated, it literally melts this metal cone, and due to its shape, it creates a bullet of molten metal moving at a very high velocity. This penetrates the armor, creating a hole and allowing the explosive shockwave and shrapnels to damage anything inside of it. And the explosives? And that's literally the system's warhead. Everything else we've seen so far, and everything we'll see in the rest of the episode, are just to enable this tiny piece to hit its target. Here is a video that its manufacturer released from its initial testing during the R&D phase. You can see it here. For testing, they used a compressed air propulsion system and this body instead of an actual missile. And here is the footage. Now, remember the optical sensors that were pointing downwards because the missile is designed to detonate while flying over the target? Well, that's the same reason why the warhead is placed sideways too, with its penetrator pointing downwards. Worth noting that this is also the reason why the missile's body has this widening part here, to fit the EFP in this sideways orientation. Also, this is from a Kilo 170 Alpha 2 high-explosive anti-tank guided missile for NLAW. There could be other missile models too. Alright, right after the missile's nose sensors and the shaped charge, there is a plastic tube with the missile's electronics and control systems. We talked about how the distance and mode levers are configuring the thresholds of the sensors, but there is another important part that is set based on those levers. The flight control electronics. So while the operator is doing that tracking, those electronics here pre-calculate the ideal trajectory to hit this target. For example, in the case of OTA, how high the missile should fly, when should it descend, etc. All of those, though, are pre-calculations, meaning they are based on the tracking. Once fired, the missile will just execute this flight path and detonate its shaped charge based on the signals of the optical and magnetic sensors we saw previously. We also see the logo of Technoflex here. According to the company's LinkedIn profile, Technoflex is the UK's largest design and manufacturer of flexible, sculptured and flex-rigid multi-layer circuits with assembly and inspection all in-house. And here is a look to the connector that configures this system. Remember this component we saw at the NLAW tube earlier? Pay attention to this specific part, since this is what actually activates the missile inside. Here is how that same part looks on the missile itself. The last two modules of the missile are this and this, the launch rocket and flight motor. This is the module that is activated once the trigger button is pressed, and here you can see it in action. Here is how it looks when it's stripped down. It's a simple solid fuel rocket, and specifically that red thing is its solid fuel. And the author of those photographs even show us how its solid fuel looks like once activated. And in conclusion, that was our today's artifact. Not really an artifact from our collection, but more of an open source TECHINT attempt to see what we could learn. Please let us know what you think, what did we miss, or any other feedback. Also, what do you think about the NLAW system after getting those insights? Was it what we expected or not? We hope that this gave you another perspective into the inner workings of those modern, advanced weapon systems and helps you see why nation states are always cautious about what they use, since everything we presented in this episode is from publicly available information. And if we could find those out, you can be absolutely certain that TECHINT professionals would be able to find way, way more. From discovering weaknesses, to reverse engineering for reproduction purposes, or anything else in between. And this is why we say that in the spy world, nothing is as it seems.